that corner.
Only a fool would try it.
So actually, when the player produces notes, he does have a thing called a slide, which is not really any more help than the tubing itself. See, the air goes straight through the darn thing, that's right. This reminds me of a song. The music goes round and round, right? Now is something to create resistance. Resistance produces the melody, and it does happen. It's the lips. There's an old saying that people with fat lips play better brass instruments. That would make me sensational. I've got fat lips. But Tommy Dorsey's were almost invisible, so it doesn't prove a thing. There is no method here at all. He really had very thin lips. It's a big question, and there is no answer yet given. But nonetheless, the player has to buzz. So that if I do this, it sounds like a beginner, but that's supposed to, once I was a beginner. The idea is they get a sound. From that, you try to build something, but it's very difficult because the thing about the slide is, this is marvelous, you'll take this home with you. There is a physical situation that develops when the slide is moved. When I move it this way, it's pulling air out of my mouth. Literally becomes a suction pump. Now how am I to deal with it? I'll be damned if I know. Or does James Wakeham or anybody else get it? Trombone players just, they rely on luck, mostly. And here's the worst part, when you move the slide back, you get it in the face. And you can see this. And actually, I got a tie on that would really be dangling in the wind. Now, with that happening, how am I to play? It's a good question, and it does point up the difficulty of the instrument. Because on top of finding the right place on the slide, you have to consider that going this way, the air is coming back into your mouth freely, sometimes down the esophagus. And if the slide goes that way, it's pulling it out of your mouth, but it's not helping you a bit. And so to overcome that sort of a thing takes a lifetime. And happily, I haven't led a lifetime yet. I'm still working on it. But it did me a lot of good to hear even Tommy Dorsey miss the high note on Getting Sentimental Over You. I felt so good about that. The band came out of the pit at the Strand Theater, and he did. And that was the best day of my life. Tommy Dorsey can do it. But I think by this time you've gathered that I can play in very short bursts. There's a thing that's needed to play a brass instrument. It's called muscles all over your body, really. Especially in the face. Facial muscles. At the end of 6 years with Stan Kenton, I had so many facial muscles it was hard to smile. Try to get the corners of the lip to rise was really a knockout. If you're there, I think we can begin. Peter, are you with me? Okay. Anyway, there's an old joke. Once there were two trombone players, now there are millions. No, that's not good. And I told a bunch of you yesterday that young Elian was going to get his own band, Elian Gonzalez, and apparently there was a raid and they took him this morning. The FBI, it gives me a great feeling around the country. They broke the doors down and took the little darling. But I doubt seriously that he'll leave the country. It was a it's a ploy to get all the Cubans in Cuba to the United States at first. One by one, they're going to be found on the ocean, on the beach. Somebody in Cuba will demand them back and come here to do it. And meanwhile, nobody's going home. I'll leave you with that. Think that over. Are we together? Okay. Very good.
What can you say? Captain Milt Bernhart.
Actually, it worked to my advantage that you all showed up so early. And I got a chance to warm up a little bit, and now you won't hear another note of trombone. Because there's a lot coming. He's told you that my name is Art Schaffner and Marx. And of course, I've come all the way from the wilds of Southern California to talk to you this afternoon about a subject very close to my heart, San Kenton's trombones. Listen.
Featured trombones that played in unison
which requires some doing, and Stan happened to love the French style of music. He was crazy about Ravel, he learned a lot about Debussy, and he employed the trombones as French horns on purpose. Let's just listen to the first recording of Artistry and Rhythm, featuring now, there were three trombones in 43, 42. They added Bart Barcelona on third trombone, and they were used as French horns. Listen.
Born in Denmark,
family moved to the U.S. in 1934. He grew up and was educated in New York City, and in his teens, he got attention playing with local New York band, Shorty Allen's band, which, by the way, Shelly Mann was on. Then he played with Sonny Dunham's band, pre-war, then went into service into the Coast Guard. And after the service, I heard him with Benny Goodman, briefly, and Alvino Ray. Anybody here remember Alvino Ray? Seems that Alvino Ray was very much aware of Stan Kenton and the sound. And right after the war, he had eight brass. He had actually more than eight brass in the band that had the King Sisters. And what he did was, he set them up as two sections of brass, three trumpets, several trombones on one side of the bandstand, and the identical same on the other side, and they never played together, they answered each other. And it was an experiment, and it didn't really pay off, but it was a great idea. Kay Winding was a member of that band. Got a little bit to play. It was Shelly Mann who called Stan's attention to Kay's biting bebop jazz and his Bill Harris-tinged sound. Winding joined the band in late 45. Here's an extract from World on a String, and we hear the outgoing and the incoming. The outgoing is a Tommy Dorsey lead trombone player named Miff Sines, who was about to leave the band. He plays the melody in the Dorsey style. It was about the last time you'd hear that on the Kenton record. But we also
Thank you. into that corner.
And he stayed only a short while on the band. I had arrived on the band by that time. Was in the trombone section with Skip, and the only thing about it is when a man plays that high, the only people that can hear it are canine. Dogs heard it. And Maynard Ferguson the same when he first joined the band. But Skip went back to Elmira, New York, a small town, and stayed there. I think he got out of the business. And in many ways, that's too bad. He was a very good player and played the original solo on Travelin' Light, the Paul Whiteman record that featured Billie Holiday. If you hear it, it starts with a trombone solo. It was Skip Layton. I loved him dearly. Lovely man. Now, Bart Barcelona, by this time, had switched to bass trombone in the bottom. And now this strong presence, very important to the sound of the trombone section, became more important in the evolution of the Kenton trombone sound. Here's Bart. He didn't play a lot of solos. He was very important to the section, but at the Hollywood Bowl in 1948, Bart demonstrated the bass trombone, his new bass trombone, to the audience. Let's listen to Bart Barcelona. Thank you.
Invention
for
bass trombone, Bart Barcelona.
Thank you. Stan came into the band room one evening when we were playing somewhere on the road and had a lead sheet, Ernest Lacona's Peanut Vendor, I think it was Lacona. And Sam had gotten the idea that this would make a record. He didn't convince anybody in the band. He had a piano sheet and he said, let's go out there now and we'll make up the arrangement as we go. Who wants to play the first chorus? And instantly the room was empty. And I wasn't one of the first, I was the farthest from the door. As far as I was concerned, it should have been a saxophone solo. What do you mean trombone? There wasn't a trombone in all of Cuba in those days. But there I was and I was caught. I'll be honest with you, I was a ham and I grabbed it. But I was sorry afterwards because I couldn't do a thing with it, but I ended up doing the record. Truth is, I always felt better about this passage from Johnny Richards' soliloquy. Much better. Thanks, Pete.
Fitz playing almost legitimately.
it might be mistaken for a member of the Royal Philharmonic, a legitimate player. The notes had to be in tune and right on the button, but using the slide could be a crutch. I wouldn't want to say Tommy Dorsey did it just to, not to be caught playing out of tune. He did it because he was convinced it was beautiful. But for Sam Kenton, this was perfection. And there wasn't much vibrato. Some trombone players later on added some, and maybe a little too much. I'll let you know where when you hear it. Now, Bart Barcelona left the band also on bass trombone. After a fruitless search, we spent a long time looking for a bass trombone player. We weren't having any luck at all. I could play in this band, swing a little, play all the music, be right, even play a solo. Bob Fitzpatrick spoke up and he said he'd met a youngster on Gene Krupa's band. The fellow had just started to play bass trombone, and that's true. His name, George Roberts. Now, George had just begun, but already he was a stand-up. He not only got the job, he reinvented the horn. He really did. Listen to this, George Roberts.
Wait a minute, George Roberts. I said bottom. That's better.
My goodness. And that meant a lot to the general effect of the sound of the band. There was a lot more bottom added at that point. Bill Russo is in the section too, and although his arranging and composing earn him acclaim to this day, he did play darn good jazz trombone. Now he has told me that this solo, told somebody that this solo wasn't his, it was Fitz's, but let's just imagine that it's Bill Russo. I believe it was. Let's hear it, Peter. Gene Krupa really was a training camp for a lot of Kenton people. He always was. This man joined the Kenton band and, believe me, shook up the trombone world forevermore. He's a tragic figure, but to hear him play, you never know it. Isn't that interesting? Was a paradox. He added personality, vitality, and exuberance to the Kenton menu. And many say for the first time, the Kenton band swung. True. Here's Frank Rosolino telling his own unique story. Play it, Peter.
Yes. get into that corner.
Sam took the band back on the road. And he was aided in his trials and tribulations in the latter part of his career with a man who would be with him until almost the end. For 10 years, Dick Shearer, who became his right hand, left hand, leader of the band, trombone section, sometimes leader of the band. Now, I'll tell you a great ironic story. I met Dick Shearer about 2 years before he joined Kenton. I was invited to somebody's house to play some ensembles, duets, trios, and I like to do that to keep some kind of lip going. And I was introduced to this young fellow, Dick Shearer. And we traded anecdotes about where we had been. I didn't know much about him. And it turns out he said to me that day, he said, "You were with Kenton, weren't you? This is lovely, I like it." He said, "You were with Kenton." I said, "You know I was with Kenton." And he said, "I'd never do that." I said, "Who have you been with?" He said, "The Righteous Brothers." And that's not a joke. And he said, "You know, with the Righteous Brothers, we hardly have to play. We just show up, and there's a red carpet. We fly from job to job, and we stay in the best hotels. We can even destroy the furniture in the rooms, throw stuff out of windows." And he'd already lived his life here. But he said, "Kenton, forget it." Well, he joined the band, didn't he? And he was there for 10 years. And ironically, he fit into Stan's plans like a glove. He liked the road, he adored Stan, he was a natural born mother hen, and he played very much, perhaps too much, in the vaunted Kenton style. Just a little bit more vibrato than I would have wanted to do, but he was a very strong player. For sure, the only resemblance between Dick Shearer and Tommy Dorsey at this point in history is that they both owned trombones. Stan's dream had come true. He had reinvented the horn. Here's Dick at his best on a live recording made in England of Hank Levy's Chiapas, Dick Shearer.
Thank you.
closing theme and things come down to the end. That's why closing themes were invented. Because we have to say it's over, the evening's over, sometimes a lifetime is over. What did you do during that lifetime? Well, we're here this weekend to assess what Stan did. The turnout tells us what he did. He was a success, a big one. Let's listen to the closing theme and bring this program to an end. His image hangs over me.